Deryck Cooke is currently working on a book about Wagner, and in an earlier talk about The Ring, he discussed some of the ways in which commentators had approached the tetralogy in the past. In this talk, Mr. Cooke goes on to argue that the role of the flight motive has been misunderstood and has given rise to basic misconceptions of Wagner's poetic intentions.
In the first of these two talks, I pointed out what I consider to be the fundamental weakness of all existing commentaries on The Ring: their failure to examine the meaning of the work in sufficient depth, owing to their concentration on the verbal text, which is only the conceptual framework, at the expense of the music, which actually communicates Wagner's meaning. And I traced this weakness back to the very first commentator on The Ring, Baron Hans Paul von Wolzogen, the friend of Wagner's, who issued a thematic guide to the work in 1878, 2 years after its first production at Bayreuth. "This little book," I said, "remains basic in the field, since it identified many of the main musical ideas of the work and indicated Wagner's method of continually reintroducing them as reminiscences. But being only a first attack on the problem, it inevitably had several serious shortcomings, and no later commentator has ever gone beyond them. These shortcomings are five, and I dealt with four of them in my first talk. But it's the fifth and final one that's been really fatal, and it's this that I want to deal with tonight. Every commentator might have been saved from taking a completely lopsided view of The Ring if he hadn't followed unquestioningly Wolzogen's complete misinterpretation of the function of one single musical idea, and if he hadn't accepted the completely inaccurate and misleading title which Wolzogen gave to it. This was the label of Fluchtmotiv, or flight motive, which he attached to part of the swift, agitated minor theme that first appears when Freya runs on in Act II of the Rheingold, pursued by the giants. This idea. It may seem a very small point, but in fact it's absolutely crucial to our understanding of what Wagner was getting at in The Ring. This is the whole theme. And the first thing to notice about it is that it's attached to Freya. Let's hear it in context as it first appears. Fricka briefly describes Freya's approach. Then, as Freya enters, the theme is given out swiftly by the first violins, and after that, she begins calling for help. This theme, as you can hear, is manifestly attached to Freya, just as Loge's music is manifestly attached to him when he first enters a few minutes later. And just as Loge's music continues to reappear from the Valkyrie onwards, when he himself has vanished from the ring, recalling his symbolic function as god of fire, so does Freya's theme continue to reappear when she has vanished, recalling her symbolic function as goddess of love. And again, like Loge's music, Freya's theme splits into its component parts, which appear separately. In this case, it's two quite different halves. First half, and second half. Let's call them Freya 1 and Freya 2 for convenience. Now, Wolzogen noticed this splitting up of the theme, but for some reason best known to himself, he gave the title of Freya motive to Freya 1 only, and he gave the title of flight motive to Freya 2. Let's begin by seeing what happens to Freya 1. When Freya enters, she's in a great state of distress, and so the whole Freya theme is naturally presented in a swift and agitated form. But later, as Wolzogen indicated, Freya 1 settles down into a slow and sinuous major form. The original form, and the slow and sinuous major form. This form first establishes itself in Loge's monologue, in which he praises love as the creative force of life. It introduces the monologue, and it rounds off each of its cadences. The fact that Freya is the goddess of love, plus the fact that this slow major form of Freya I is used in Loge's monologue praising love as the creative force of life, plus the actual nature of the musical idea itself, suggests that Wagner associated Freya I with sex, sexual attraction, and sexual love. And this is confirmed each time the idea returns, as for example in Act I of the Valkyrie during the love duet of Siegmund and Sieglinde. Siegmund's sexual desire begins to be aroused when Sieglinde hangs on his neck and gazes into his face. And when he first becomes really ardent, the slow major form of Freya I rounds off his cadence. This is plain sailing, and it's all implicit in Wolzogen's book, even if he doesn't bring out the sexual significance of the idea, but merely connects it with Freya, whom he calls the goddess of youth and beauty. Now let's see what happens to Freya II, which Wolzogen insisted on calling the flight motive. One thing that happens to it, in fact, is what happens to Freya I. It settles down into a slow major form. In fact, it does so first of all in conjunction with Freya I, in a passage which Wolzogen seems to have overlooked. This is when the amorous giant Fasolt claims Freya as the wage for building Valhalla for Wotan. The whole of Freya's theme, in a slow major form, transfigures Fasolt's words, "We labour to win ourselves a woman who, lovely and gentle, shall dwell with us poor creatures." Here's the original agitated form of Freya's whole theme. And here's the slow major form of it, which transfigures Fasolt's words, beginning in the orchestra and finally moving into his vocal line. Now let's hear the passage as it occurs in the Rheingold. But this is only an intermediate stage. Freya II finds its definitive slow major form in Act I of the Valkyrie, at the point where Siegmund and Sieglinde look into each other's eyes and fall in love at first sight. Here's part of the original minor form of the idea again. And here it is in the major. And here, much slower, is the main love theme of Siegmund and Sieglinde. Thank you. Incidentally, it's worth noticing that the whole theme is spun entirely out of the three-note figure that's the basis of Friar II. In this case, the fact that Freya is the goddess of love, plus the fact that Freya too is used as the main love theme of the two suffering Volsungs, plus the actual nature of the musical idea itself, suggests that Wagner associated Freya too with love in its totality, not excluding sex, but certainly including deep sympathy and compassion. We can confirm this by two notable later recurrences. When Siegfried first tries to understand the mystery of human love, about which he knows nothing, since he has met no one in all his life but the evil dwarf Mimer who has brought him up, he's fascinated by the mating of the animals in the forest and the loving way they bring up their young together. As he sings about this to Mimer, a long yearning theme keeps entering on the strings. Its beginning has nothing to do with Freya too. But at that point, the slow major version of Freya II strikes in, very much in the form it took as the main love theme of Siegfried's parents, Siegmund and Sieglinde. I'll play the whole melody again, emphasizing the entry of Freya II. Now, here's the passage from the first act of Siegfried. The yearning theme begins it, and it recurs twice. On its first appearance, keep following the cello melody when Siegfried's voice enters, and on the third appearance, likewise, keep following the horn line and ignore the entry of the voice. Another recurrence of Freya II I'd like to use as an example is when it strikes in with great force on the full orchestra in the interlude between the prelude of the Twilight of the Gods and its first act proper. Siegfried and Brynhilde have taken a tumultuously happy leave of each other as he sets out towards the Rhine for new adventures. Their love in all its aspects is now at its height. The stage direction reads, "She looks away towards Siegfried in the valley. She waves to him with rapturous gestures. Her happy smile shows that she is watching the hero as he gaily sets off on his journey." And this is represented in the orchestra, after the sound of Siegfried's horn dies away, by a passionate outburst of the slow major form of Freya II. So all this is plain sailing too, even if nothing at all is made of it in Walzogen's book, where Freya II remains simply the flight motive, as it has done for all the other commentators. It seems obvious that both halves of Freya's theme recur quite naturally throughout the ring in connection with lovers, Freya I representing sexual love and Friar II, Love in its Totality. But the two ideas differ greatly in the matter of importance. Friar I, representing sexual love only, remains a subsidiary idea, recurring only rarely, and practically always in the one slow major form. But Friar II, representing love in its totality, is one of the central and most fertile ideas in the whole of the Ring. It recurs as often as any, in more different forms than most, and undergoes a great deal of symphonic development. It appears in the major and in the minor, slow and fast, soft and loud, and in every possible combination of these, to represent the different aspects of love: its ecstasy, its misery, its contentment, its frustration, its longing, its fulfillment, and so on. Just let's consider a few examples. We've heard the soft, slow, major form of Friar II as the main love theme of Siegmund and Sieglinde, full of mingled ecstasy and longing. But when Siegmund feels bitter despair at the thought that Sieglinde can almost certainly never be his, the orchestra presents a loud, slow, minor version of the same idea. On the other hand, at the end of this act, when Siegmund and Sieglinde fall into one another's arms in a tumult of ecstasy, the orchestra presents the same idea in a loud, quick, major version, which becomes more and more telescoped as it's developed. In Siegfried, although Friar II does appear as itself in various forms, its most important function is to generate two new musical ideas in the love duet of Siegfried and Brynhilde. The first is the broad theme sung by both of them in imitation to the words "O Heil der Mutter," when they glorify the dead Sieglinde as the mother who bore Siegfried. If we take the three-note figure that's the basis of Friar II, and if we drop the lower note further and further, this figure is still eminently recognizable. Transformations of this kind are the basis of the Heil der Mutter theme of Siegfried and Brynhilde. There are four of them in as many bars. And now, here's the theme as it enters in the opera. Derivation seems rather far-fetched, we can support it from a later passage where Wagner himself merges the two different ideas into one, following his frequent procedure of transforming an existing idea into another existing one closely related to it. When Brynhilde sings to Siegfried, "Thine will I ever be," the orchestra starts the Heil der Mutter theme. Then both the orchestra and the voice continue with Friar II. Here's the passage in the opera. The other new theme generated by Friar II in the love duet of Siegfried and Brynhilde is the so-called love's resolution motive, introduced by the horns at the climax of the duet. This goes back to the closing music of Act I of the Valkyrie, which we heard earlier. As you remember, when Siegmund and Sieglinde fall into each other's arms, the orchestra has a fast, loud, major version of Friar II, which is telescoped as it's developed. And the telescoping works in this way. The three-note figure on which Friar II is based is hammered out over and over a tone lower each time. And if we now transpose that progression into another key and alter the rhythm, we have the basis of the even more telescoped form, which is the big horn theme known as Love's Resolution. And again, if that derivation seems far-fetched, we can still support it from a later passage in The Twilight of the Gods, where Wagner himself confirmed it. It's the big outburst of the loud, slow, major version of Friar II, which we heard earlier, where Brynhilde waves joyfully to Siegfried as he sets off towards the Rhine in search of new adventures. Here, the three-note figure that's the basis of Friar II is made very clear by the actual rhythm of the passage. But Wagner dissolves the rhythm in a free, sliding passage. Then he gives the figure a new rhythm. He goes on to make a downward sequence of it. But he ties the repeated notes. Until we find we've merged imperceptibly into the theme known as Love's Resolution. It all sounds like a bit of functional analysis, but in fact it's one of Wagner's most superb thematic transformations. Just two further examples, both from The Twilight of the Gods. In Act II, when the betrayed Brynhilde gives vent to her grief over Siegfried's faithlessness in love, her vocal line turns to Freya II in a slow minor version. And finally, in the closing scene of the whole tetralogy, in the section where Brynhilde apostrophizes the dead Siegfried as having been preeminent alike in love and in the betrayal of love, the orchestral score is permeated with Freya too, in many different forms, ranging from the suffering of the fast, loud, minor version to the transfiguration of the slow, soft, major version. Must have noticed that every single one of those reappearances of Freya II is connected with the love element of the drama in some way or another, and has nothing whatever to do with flight. How then did Walzogen come to give the idea the name of the flight motive? It can only have been that he was misled by the occasional reappearance of the idea in its original fast, loud, minor form, in various rhythmic guises, as a basis for extended passages of symphonic development representing lovers in a state of agitation or distress. For example, it does represent Sieglinde in Act II of the Valkyrie as she runs madly onwards in a state of shame and remorse while Siegmund runs after her and tries to comfort her. As far as I can see, this is the only time in The Ring when Freya II is really connected with the idea of flight, except for its original appearance in the Rheingold when Freya herself was fleeing from the giants. And even so, these are lovers in flight, just as in the first instance it was the goddess of love who was in flight. The curious thing is that Walzogen actually noticed the identity between Freya II and the love theme of Siegmund and Sieglinde, but he was blind to its significance. Sticking to his view of Freya II as the flight motive, he explained the identity as follows with some very special pleading. For the Volsung twins, it is also a matter of flight. Out of this trouble grows their love, and their love lives by this trouble. Intellectually, very plausible, no doubt, but it led Walzogen into a patent musico-dramatic absurdity. He labelled the first four bars of the great love theme of Siegmund and Sieglinde as flight, and the rest of it as love. This is, of course, manifest nonsense. As we've seen, the whole melody is a love theme based on the three-note figure that's the basis of Freya II. Anybody can make a mistake, but it seems strange that all the subsequent commentators should have accepted without question the messy and confusing state of affairs handed down to them by this fatal mistake of Walzogen's. It might have been expected that someone would rectify the error for three separate reasons. In the first place, nowhere do we find Wagner detaching a segment of a theme introduced in connection with the central symbol of the drama for the purpose of using it as a mere figuration portraying a physical activity. In any case, this swift, loud, minor form of Freya II has an intensely emotional character, which lifts it far above the level of mere hurry music. And even more to the point, the idea itself, in all its forms, is a basic term of Wagner's musical vocabulary which he used throughout his life's work exclusively in connection with love. Two examples may make this clear. In Act II of Tristan, while Isolde is waiting for Tristan to come to her, she tells Brangaena that it's Frau Minna, the ancient German love goddess, who has inflamed her with her fatal passion. And the new orchestral theme that enters at this point incorporates the idea we've been considering, which is attached in the ring to Freya, the ancient Norse love goddess. Here's the theme as it appears in Tristan. Later, the idea is detached from the theme and developed on its own. And this initiates one of Wagner's greatest climaxes, as Isolde sings of the spell of Frau Minna, who demands the darkness of night for the celebration of her rites. Another example I'd like to use of Freya II appearing outside the ring is one in the Mastersingers. Eva, who is to be given in marriage by her father to the winner of the song contest, fears that her beloved Walter will never win it, and she hates the thought of being forced to marry someone else, except, possibly, old Hans Sachs, who is a widower and who she knows is very sweet on her. In Act II, she cajoles him, pleading with him to enter and win the contest. And the way she makes up to him stirs his susceptible heart painfully. At this point, where Sachs reproaches her, saying, "Sweet Eva, are you trying to throw dust into my eyes?" the idea we've been calling Freya II steals in on the orchestra and spins itself out as a troubled melodic line. And so on. Here's the passage in the opera. Listen to the orchestra behind the voice, first the solo clarinet and then the strings. My submission is then that this ubiquitous musical idea of Wagner's is one of the basic terms of his musical vocabulary, which expresses the feeling of love in its various aspects. That it therefore appears quite naturally in the ring in connection with Freya, the goddess of love, and with lovers, and that Walzogen made the biggest blunder in his book when he called it the flight motive. The blunder has never been rectified, and it has inevitably hamstrung the commentators. Newman did actually boggle at the term flight motive, but he could find no better way of solving the difficulty than to evade it. In his commentary on the ring in Wagner Nights, he refers to Freya II on its first appearance as follows. It has been a source of much trouble to the analysts. They have dubbed it the motive of flight because it occurs now and later in some sort of connection with this idea. But we meet with it also in Wagner in quite other connections, and the truth seems to be that it was a musical tick into which he was inclined to fall on various occasions, sometimes, as here, with a specific purpose, sometimes without any. Thus, the main love theme of The Ring and its masterly development and transformation throughout the whole work is reduced to a musical tick, and Wagner is made to appear careless and confused through the confusion and carelessness of the commentator. In fact, Newman continues to refer to the quick minor version of Freier II throughout his commentary as the flight motive. And when he comes to the great love theme of Siegmund and Sieglinde, he doesn't even mention its identity with that motive, nor even with that supposed musical tick. One Wagnerian scholar did offer an alternative name for the idea. This was not a commentator, but Alfred Lorenz, who wrote an exhaustive structural analysis of The Ring in his monumental four-part work, The Secret of Form in Richard Wagner. He was not concerned with elucidating the meaning of The Ring at all, but he had to use Wolzogen's names for the various musical ideas, of course, for the purpose of easy reference in his analysis, and he jibbed at some of them, particularly the flight motive. He described the title as too narrow, and suggested that the most reasonable name would be the note motif, note being a word meaning need, trouble, and distress. He gave as his reason for this a division of the basic motive into two separate intervals, a falling tone or semitone, like a sigh, and a rising third, like a question. And he fancifully set two words to them, wehe, warum, or in English, alas, why. The trouble is that this takes no account of the many different expressive effects the motive has according to whether it's major or minor, quick or slow. The slow minor version, as when Siegmund despairs of possessing Sieglinde, certainly conveys need, trouble, and distress. But the fast major version, when Siegmund and Sieglinde are actually united, expresses the direct opposite. Regarded as a love motive, however, the idea's ability to convey various states of depression and elation makes perfect sense. Robert Donington, in his commentary, has generously acknowledged certain ideas I put forward to him privately, including my interpretation of Freier II as a love motive. But he couldn't develop all its implications, since the love element of the drama as such didn't seem of cardinal importance to him. He preferred to describe Freier II as follows. The notes, in various rhythms, may convey almost any sort of involvement, from fearful agitation, through urgent passion, to profound compassion. True enough, but only in contexts involving love and lovers, as we've seen. And now, what does it all amount to? Well, in the first place, the view of Freier II as the flight motive can lead to misinterpretation on a very large scale. For example, when the idea occurs swiftly at the very end of the first act of the Valkyrie, it will be assumed to indicate that Siegmund and Sieglinde run away from Hunding's hut immediately in flight. I can't see any other reason why so many producers make them run out through the door on the stage when the stage direction simply says he draws her to him with passionate ardour. Presumably, since Hunding's in a drugged sleep, and Wagner asks for the curtain to fall quickly, they consummate their love and beget Siegfried then and there. Or again, when the idea bursts out passionately as Siegfried leaves Brynhilde in search of new adventures, it will be assumed to indicate that he's in some abstruse sense fleeing from her, whereas, in fact, it expresses her passionate love for him as she watches him go. The failure of the commentators to understand the true nature of Freier II means that Freier's very function as goddess of love has passed unnoticed. Wolzogen described her as the goddess of youth and beauty. Bernard Shaw called her Fricka's sister, Freier, with her golden apples, who in her function as the prize Wotan agrees to pay for Valhalla stands for woman. Aylmer Bust did refer to her as the goddess of love, but he rather curiously added, and of domestic happiness, and he didn't give her any real significance in his commentary. Newman's description of her is the goddess of youth and beauty and health and charm, which is a case of hitting the nail on the head without actually driving it home. Donnington gets as far as the goddess of youth and youthful love. But his adjective youthful is a depreciative one, since he goes on to describe youthful love as a passing, if inevitable and valuable, phase of human life, and nowhere does he equate Friar with the principle of love itself. In fact, Donnington insisted to me in private discussion that Wagner's Friar is not the goddess of love, nor is the mythological counterpart on which Wagner based her, the Norse goddess Freya. Actually, in one of Wagner's main mythological sources, the Icelandic prose Edda of Snorri Sturluson, dating from about 1220, there's a list of the correct ways of describing the Norse goddess Freya, and it includes the label goddess of love. But in any case, Wagner relied heavily on the scholarship of his own time, and particularly on Jakob Grimm's monumental work Deutsche Mythologie, which deals exhaustively with German and Scandinavian mythology. And Grimm came to the conclusion that whereas Frigg, the Norse counterpart of Fricka, was equivalent to the Roman Juno, the wife of the chief god Jupiter, Freya, the Norse counterpart of Freyr, was equivalent to the Roman Venus, and we know who she was. And it's quite obvious in the Rheingold that Wagner followed Grimm in regarding Freya as the goddess of love. Wotan, having promised Freya to the giants as a wage for building Valhalla, is accused by his wife Fricka of bartering away love and the worth of woman. And at this point, the orchestra plays the theme associated with Alberic's renunciation of love. Also, Loge, having promised to find a substitute wage for Freya, which will be acceptable to the giants, later says that such a thing is impossible, since no man will accept a substitute for love, which is the creative force of life. And at this point, the orchestra plays the first half of Freya's own theme, what I've called Freya One, associated throughout the tetralogy with sex and sexual love. It can, of course, be objected that if Wagner did intend Freya to be the goddess of love, she ought surely to cut a far more impressive figure. Why is she such a minor character? But this surely is the very point Wagner intended to make. The love goddess should certainly cut a far more impressive figure, but how can she when Wotan thinks so little of her as to pledge her as a wage for Valhalla? Freya stands as the goddess of love in a world which has rejected love. In scene one of the Rheingold, Alberic has renounced love altogether in return for world domination. And in scene two, Wotan's own appetite for world domination has led him to seek it at the possible price of love in the person of the love goddess. In the world of the Rheingold ruled over by Wotan, love doesn't exist, or rather, it has shrunk into the weak, helpless, hunted figure of Freya. And now at last I'm in a position to justify my view that Waldsogen's misunderstanding of this musical idea I've called Freya II was a fatal one, and that it has completely hamstrung all the subsequent commentators who so unthinkingly accepted his misinterpretation of it. The view of Freya II as the flight motive has not only obscured Freya's own function as the central symbol of love in the ring, it has left her a mere subsidiary character in the Rheingold who afterwards disappears and leaves little mark on the tetralogy as a whole. But once we realise that Freya is the goddess of love, that Freya too is the main love motive of the ring, and that this motive expresses the rising and falling fortunes of love after Freya herself vanishes from the scene, one whole dark side of the tetralogy is illuminated. The work becomes quite clearly a conflict between the love of power and the power of love. In fact, the work becomes a parable about the world we live in. It begins in the Rheingold by representing the loveless, power-ridden world of human civilization, in which Wotan and Alberic stand as two complementary symbols of the types of men who try to rule the world. On the one hand, there's Wotan, the ambitious, ruthless, but ultimately civilizing ruler, whose quest for world domination has led him to ignore and despise love in the person of Freya. On the other hand, there's Alberic, the revengeful, psychotic underdog, who expels love from his being altogether in order to pursue a criminal totalitarianism unhampered. But without an understanding of the function of Freya as the goddess of love, pledged by Wotan as a wage for the power symbol of Valhalla, Wagner's composite double-sided image of the power men who rule our world will remain completely unnoticed. In the remainder of the ring, Alberic doesn't change. He continues to be a loveless power maniac, motivated only by hatred and a consuming desire for revenge, and he never achieves his aim of dominating the world. Wotan, however, remains in control of the world for some time, and after making criminal mistakes of his own, he does slowly develop. He gradually recognizes the supreme value of love, embodied in his own offspring, Siegmund and Sieglinde, Siegfried and Brynhilde. But again, unless we understand the function of Freya too as the main love theme of the tetralogy, Wagner's representation of the gradual ascendancy of love remains vague and obscure. Finally, Wotan, in recognizing the supreme value of love, abandons his quest for power more and more, until in the end he gives it up completely. The conclusion of the ring is a metaphysical renunciation of the material world. Wotan has one of the two main power symbols, the ring, returned to the waters of the Rhine from which it came, and the other, Valhalla, destroyed by fire. And at this point, love itself disappears with everything else. But it's only by following love at the expense of power that Wotan has risen to this level. Some people seem to believe that Wagner was a Nazi before his time. But a clear understanding of the ring reveals that he was a profound artistic mind of the most moral and idealistic type. He was also an optimist, one might add, in imagining that humanity would progress from power mania through love to an apprehension of metaphysical reality. Still, time could prove him right in the long run. The very long run.